Hello dear learners, welcome to Amit Sinha IAS Academy, an online initiative. I, Nidhi Mishra, ready in front of you with the understanding on caste by Andhra Bethe. Let's understand today what is the take of Andhra Bethe on caste. In our last video, we have done M.N. Srinivas's understanding on caste, right? So, and we are doing today caste and the various perspectives given by G.S. Ghurye, M.N. Srinivas and Andhra Bethe. So, this is the last section which we are understanding today. Why I have taken Andhra Bethe at the end? Because we had to understand G.S. Ghurye and M.N. Srinivas before understanding Andhra Bethe. Why? Because Andhra Bethe refutes G.S. Ghurye, refutes M.N. Srinivas's understanding on caste, and he gives absolutely a different understanding on caste. So let's start it. See, in India, the inequality is widespread. It's prevalent all across, and that is what Andhra Bethe also talks about. Andhra Bethe, just like M.N. Srinivas, has done a field study, but he has done his field study on Tanjore district, Sripuram village, Tanjore district. So on the basis of this study of this village, Andhra Bethe talks about the stratification, the social stratification, which is so prevalent and evident in Indian society. But before stating what are the takes of Andhra Bethe on caste and social inequality and stratification, he first refutes Louis Dumont, G.S. Ghurye and even M.N. Srinivas for their take on Brahmanic supremacy and Brahmanic Sanskritization process. He refutes Louis Dumont over his take that Brahmanic supremacy is universal, and that is the only form of social inequality in India, or that even leads to social exclusion in India. So in a way, Andhra Bethe discards, Andhra Bethe refutes the understanding, the larger understanding, the prevalent understanding that caste as one major dimension or caste as the only dimension of social inequality in India. Andhra Bethe, on the basis of his study on Sripuram village, Tanjore district, he gives an example and he says that the village is divided, it's divided into three stratas. One is Brahmin people, another is non-Brahmin, and the third is Adi Dravidian. Why he has talked about these three division? He says that the caste has always been very dynamic, and there has been changes all throughout in the caste system. So what Louis Dumont says that caste division is hierarchical, caste division is rigid, and there is no social change, there is no social mobility in caste system. That is what actually Andhra Bethe refutes, and he disagrees with this understanding. He says that the village which he has studied, it is divided into three strata, and it is seen that the Brahmin people and the non-Brahmin and Adi Dravidian people are actually the one where the caste plays its role in the secular sphere. He says that the Brahmin people are not the one who are the supreme in all the spheres. They are maybe supreme in the ritual sphere, but in the secular sphere they are not supreme. Why? Because he says that the Brahmin people are now no more the landowners. Rather, the non-Brahmin people are the landowner. They are dominant caste, and they are playing an important role in party politics. They are playing a major role in deciding the politics of that particular region. He also says that, and he brings his objective reality, the study of village, as an objective reality, and he says that there has been social change. This change is not in one day, that the Brahmin people are no more the dominant caste or the dominant people in that region, and it has been over the period of time. He says that earlier in past India, caste, class and power used to coincide. Now remember, caste, class and power, and that is what is the hallmark of Andre Bethe, his analytical and study, his dynamic study on caste. So just like Weber, he follows a Trinitarian approach to study with the village, which is Siripuram, Tanjore district. He has brought into the understanding of caste as a form of social stratification, he has brought into the role of power and class also. So he has studied the social stratification, the social inequality in India on the three dimensions, that is caste, class and power nexus. So he says that the non-Brahmin who has become more and more dominant, it has happened over the period of time. And how has it happened? That the Brahmin people who were majorly the land owner, who were having control over land over the period of time, or with the process of marketization, because we have to understand that village is not an independent entity, not exclusive entity. It is also linked to urban areas. It is also dependent for other services on urban areas. So when land came into market economy, land started playing its role, and when the lands were being sold, the Brahmins were not the one who actually brought the land. It was non-Brahmin who started buying the lands. And because of this, what happened, that the power went into the hands of non-Brahmin. So he talks about the changes of village society, changes of village economy also. He says that in past India, there was a landowner class. He says that there was landowners in Jajmani system, especially the agricultural economy was that there was landowners and the other service provider castes. There was interdependence. So both were dependent upon each other for various services. For example, it was not acceptable for Brahmins to touch plow. So for plowing, Brahmins used to take the service from other caste. Similarly, there were other service provider castes, for example washerman, for example barber, potter. So there was a kind of interdependence. But over the period of time, when market economy started playing its role, when village also got exposure from the urban areas, so what happened, the major land owners, they converted into absentee landlords. Now who are absentee landlords? The one who were actually holding the lands, who had the power or who were controlling the land, they moved to urban areas. And from there they were controlling the land. So some other person was actually tilling the land that time. So the person who were the landowners, they moved to urban areas, maybe for other revenues and maybe for other opportunities, and they were called as absentee landlord. Landlord to the, but absentee the. Wo waha village mein present nahi hote the, wo urban areas mein present hote the, aur waha se wo apna virchasv, apna control land pe bana ke rakhe the. To dusra phase hua absentee landlord ka. Teesra phase kya hua? Ki ye market economy ke chalte, dheere dheere, absentee landlordism khatam hua, aur wo jo landlords the aur jo absentee landlord ho gaye, wo puri tarah apne land ko sell kar diye. To wahan pe jo un land ko kharidne wale the, wo non brahmin people the. Theek hai, len chote mehenge aur saste rate pe jo bhi hai jaise bhi hai unhone land ko kharida. To isse kya hua ki wahan ka jo stratification ka jo shape tha, jo face tha, that got changed. Now it was not only Brahmin who actually controlled the land and the power, but rather the non-Brahmin people also came into role play, right? So this was the change, and the change also happened over the period of time through the advent of education system. So what happened with the advent of education system, and also caste specific occupation, now people also started opting other occupations which are not caste based. So this all brought a kind of dynamism in the village economy, in the social stratification, and also in it also brought mobility in the caste. So this actually led to changes in the village economy. That is what Andhra Bete, that is what his take is on social inequality, that caste is not the only major criteria for looking into social inequality, what G.S. Gurie or what Louis Dumont says, right? So he refutes it, and he says that the social inequality is not only caste, rather it is also poverty. So poverty and caste leads to social exclusion in Indian society. वो कहते हैं कि कास्ट ही केवल एक डायमेंशन नहीं है सोशल इनइक्वालिटी का, रादर गरीबी और कास्ट दोनों जो है, जब एक इंडिविजुअल व्हेन ही और शी इज पुअर एंड आल्सो बिलोंग्स टू द लोअर स्ट्राटा ऑफ द कास्ट सिस्टम, ही सेज दैट दिस व्हाट ब्रिंग्स इनटू सोशल एक्सक्लूजन. ओके, सो दैट इज व्हाट ही रिफ्यूट्स हियर लुई डू. Then he further also says that just following the approach of Weber, he also says that caste is now playing its major role in domestic life. Okay, as we all know that there are certain features of caste system. It is endogamous, it is hierarchically arranged, it is discriminatory. So, but we have also seen, and I have also discussed in my last lecture, that how Harold Gold has studied rickshaw pullers of Lucknow, and how he has talked about that the people now are associating their caste identity in their domestic sphere but not in their public sphere. So just like Weber also here, Andhra Bete also agrees, and he says that now people do not stick to their caste identity when they are actually pursuing various occupations, first, and second, now people observe their caste identity more, not more into commensality but more as connubium. What is connubium? Commensality, that is interaction. When you are into public sphere, when you are into workplace, you actually do not bother that who is or your colleague is of which caste. ठीक है, या इवन रिक्शा पुलर जो है अपने मित्र, अपना दूसरा जो जो उसका साथी है, उसको मतलब नहीं होता है कि वो जो रिक्शा खींच रहा है वो किस जाति का है. लेकिन जब वो घर जाता है तो वो अपनी कास्ट आइडेंटिटी को फॉलो करता है. जब उसे अपनी बेटी की शादी करनी होती है, या उसे कोई दूसरा रिचुअल प्रैक्टिस, या उसे कुछ पूजा पाठ करना होता है, तो वो अपनी जाति के अनुसार उस प्रथा को निभाता है. तो हियर द कास्ट इज नाउ नो मोर अ कमेंसालिटी, रादर इट इज कन्यूबियम. कास्ट अब अपना रोल प्ले करता है किनशिप के बेसिस पे. सो जस्ट लाइक वेबर, आंद्रे बेते ऑल्सो अग्रीज टू इट. देन आंद्रे बेते सेज दैट in past India there were the in past India caste, class and power used to coincide. This he has also talked in his book Class, Status and Power. So he says that earlier the people who were of higher caste, they were the powerful people, and with that power they were having a higher social status, right? So understand that Andhra Bete says that class is open whereas caste is closed. Class is open because it is not ascriptive, it is achieved. Aap apne occupation, apni padhai, apne kaam se ise achieve karte hain, theek hai? Wahi caste jo hai, largely it is ascribed by your birth. But here also Andhra Bete refutes, and he gives example of sadhus of India, and he says that there are some sadhus who have acquired, with their merit, have acquired supra brahmanic status. So it is with their merit that they have upright, they have achieved supra brahmanic status. It is not by their birth. That is what he talks about when he talks about Indian sadhus. So, but largely caste is given by, it's ascriptive in nature and it is closed. It does not allow mobility so easily. It allows mobility, it allows social change over the period of time. With the process of Sanskritization, what M.N. Srinivas talks about, he endorses it. Andhrabite also endorses it, and he says that Sanskritization has brought change in social status of various castes, and it has happened over the period of time. Okay, so he says that in past India, the caste, class, and status used to coincide. कि जो उच्च जाति के थे, वो ऊंचे क्लास के भी थे और वो powerful भी थे. But now with the advent of education, but now with the decentralization of power, he talks about Panchayati Raj. He says that now and with the advent of the land getting into capital economy, or the land getting into selling and buying process, what has happened that now this the understanding that caste, class and status goes well is not true. So the person who is higher in caste may be lower in power. So now, for example, largely the Brahmins who are higher in social status, who are higher in ritual status, may not be the dominant caste in that particular region, or may not be the landowners. Okay, तो जो जरूरी नहीं है कि आज के समय में जो कास्ट में ऊंचा है वही पावरफुल है और वही स्टेटस में भी आगे. There are various because of the policy, welfare policy of the government and the reservation policy, there are other caste from the lower strata or the backward caste people also have got into good jobs and they have acquired quite a well social status in the society, and they are also powerful. So in the ritual hierarchy they are placed low. वो कास्ट में नीचे आते हैं लेकिन स्टेटस और पावर में वो ऊपर है. सो ही टॉक्स अबाउट द कास्ट, क्लास एंड पावर नेक्सस, एंड ही एम्फसाइजेस कि हमें सोशल इनइक्वालिटी अपने समाज में समझने के लिए, सोशल स्ट्रेटिफिकेशन को समझने के लिए, हम केवल कास्ट का एक डायमेंशन लेके नहीं चल सकते हैं. हमें कास्ट, स्टेटस और कास्ट, क्लास और पावर, इन तीनों को लेकर समझना होगा सोशल इनइक्वालिटी. Okay, then he talks about that what are the sources of stratification. क्योंकि वो refute करते हैं कि sources of stratification जो है, जो division है society में, वो केवल caste नहीं है. So he talks about that what are the sources of stratification, and he says that the first source of stratification is the access to land. कि सबसे ज़्यादा किसके पास land है. Then he says access to power. कि पावर अब किसके पास है, वर्चस्व किसके पास है. एंड देन थर्ड ही सेज एक्सेस टू सोशल स्टेटस विद कास्ट आइडेंटिटी. तो पहला, सबसे ज्यादा लैंड किसके पास है, दूसरा पावर किसके पास है, हु हैज द एक्सेस टू पावर, एंड थर्ड हु हैज एक्सेस टू सोशल स्टेटस ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ कास्ट आइडेंटिटी. व्हिच ही सेज दैट here also he relates that now this stratification is actually not in correlation or not in coherence with caste identity. ki jo class mein uncha hai zaruri nahi hai ki wo caste mein bhi uncha ho aur powerful bhi ho. So here he talks about ki jo the dominant caste in a particular region may be of lower caste but is playing a important role in party politics. That is what M.N. Srinivas also talks about, right? So he also talks the same thing, and here he actually endorses M.N. Srinivas's view. And Andhrabite, being a Marxist largely, he talks about the agricultural economic system and how the land now getting into when now land is marketized. That is when you start buying and selling land, then how it leads to the formation of two classes, one the landlord and another the tenants. So he says that ki ab jo village mein jo hai division jo hai wo do class mein divide ho jata hai, wo hai landlords and the tenants. ठीक है। और ये लैंडलॉर्ड और टेनेंट्स के बीच जो है इंटरडिपेंडेंस भी रहता है, बट एट द सेम टाइम इट ऑल्सो आइडेंटिफाइज कॉन्फ्लिक्ट। यहाँ कॉन्फ्लिक्ट भी है और इंटरडिपेंडेंस भी है, राइट। एंड ही सेज दैट दिस द क्लास एक्चुअली डज नॉट गिव यू मोर कॉन्शियसनेस एज वॉट कास्ट गिव्स यू। सो क्लास इज मोर ऑफ मोबाइल एंड मोर ऑफ डायनेमिक एंड कीप चेंजिंग। तो एक लैंडलॉर्ड, एक टेनेंट भी जो है ओवर अ पीरियड ऑफ टाइम एक लैंडलॉर्ड बन सकता है, राइट। तो क्लास कॉन्शियसनेस बहुत ज्यादा स्ट्रांग नहीं होता है। देन ही सेज द रोल ऑफ कास्ट इन पार्टी पॉलिटिक्स, एंड हियर ही डिसएग्रीज विद रजनी कोठारी। ही एज रजनी कोठारी सेज दैट द कास्ट एक्चुअली डिसाइड्स द फ्यूचर ऑफ डेमोक्रेसी इन इंडिया और डिसाइड्स the winning party in India, he refutes it. He says that it's not only the caste which actually plays an important role in party politics, or it plays an important role in Indian democracy, in voting behavior. Rather, he says that it's not only the caste, rather there are other dimensions also which plays an important role, and that is religion, that is gender, that is region, right, that is dominant caste. These all actually decides the voting behavior of the people. Just not on the basis of caste you can decide the voting behavior. He says that, just like M.N. Srinivas, that caste, for its own benefit, it goes for fusion as well as for fission. आपको याद होगा कल मैंने अपने लास्ट वीडियो में इस चीज की बात की कि कैसे कास्ट जो है फ्यूजन भी करता है और फीजन भी करता है। मैंने इसके इस परिपेक्ष में उत्तर प्रदेश की पॉलिटिक्स के बारे में बात किया था कि कैसे ब्राह्मण्स और अदर ओबीसी कास्ट केम इन टू पावर, और इवन यू टेक बहुजन समाजवादी पार्टी एग्जाम्पल, हाउ दे केम इन टू पावर और दे बिकेम अ, दिस इज एन फाइनेस्ट एग्जाम्पल ऑफ फ्यूजन, दैट हाउ इट एक्चुअली हेल्प्ड इन ग्रैबिंग द पावर, राइट। सो caste for its own benefit, for the gratification of its own goal and benefits and need, it actually goes for fusion, or even it goes for fission. So even Andre Bete endorses it, but he says that he says here that this caste politics, which is also, just like Srinivas, he says it is leading more to caste conflict, because it is leading more and more to caste consciousness. And little bit different and little bit away from M.N. Srinivas, Andre Bete says that as we have identified the discriminatory behavior towards the lower caste people, and how they have been in past, they have been prejudiced, and how they have suffered in past, so in order to